Hello everyone. This is the start of exam 4, and it's a very famous experiment actually performed back in 1897 by J.J. Thompson, and it's referred to as the charge to mass or E over M experiment. And here's a link to the setup for the experiment. So obviously you can't click on it here, but I posted this link along with the link to the video lecture and in Blackboard. So I would suggest you watch that. It's only like 5 minutes long, 5 or 6 minutes, and it shows you how they use a cathode ray tube to send an electron beam through both a magnetic field and an electric field. And although the person in the video does derive some equations, it's not completely what we have here, which is our main goal. And you're going to be asked to derive these formulas. Okay, so these are the given differential equations. We'll talk about them in a minute. And these are the formulas that we want to derive. And I know it looks complicated, but I'm going to give you an outline of the solution. And you're going to have to do it, though, in terms of all of the variables. And the neat thing about it is it involves things that we've already studied along with the concept of a system of differential equations. So kind of a nice application to show the idea of a system. So in his experiment, basically, if you watch this video, you'll see the idea. You just impose on this electron beam a magnetic field and an electric field. And lowercase m is the mass of the electron. Lowercase e is the charge on the electron. So that's the mass to the charge. And they're exposed to an electric field intensity that we use uppercase E for. So lowercase e or e for the charge, and uppercase E or E for the electric field intensity, and then a magnetic field intensity of H. So here's the equations that are derived from the physics concepts, and I don't expect you to, and I'm not even going to try to duplicate them here, but there's many videos out there. You can see how the equations are derived, but here's a simple layman's example. It's basically the forces in the x and y directions respectively, and it has to do with the right hand rule thrown in there, and you know, those of you in physics, I'm sure have heard of that. But for example, the force here, this is mass times acceleration, second derivative of the position, so that's a force. Here's the force from the magnetic field H, and here's the force from the electric field. So in the that's in one direction, and in the other direction, you have the acceleration in the y direction, and then the force from the magnetic field in the y direction. So you don't have to worry about that. This is what we're going to start with. We're going to let our initial conditions be such that x, y, first derivative, dx, dt, and dy, dt are all zero. And we want to show that the path is a cycloid. So these are the resulting equations. Now regarding the cycloid, I took out another sheet of paper here just to mention briefly about the cycloid. We're not going to derive the equations for the cycloid, but your general cycloid has the equations x equals 1 minus cosine t, and y equals t minus sine of t. So those are the two general equations for the cycloid, the parametric equations. And you can see that if you took out all the e's, the uppercase e or e, the m, lowercase m, your h, then your lowercase e or e, those are all constants. So if we took them all out of the picture, or let them be one, which I'm going to do momentarily, and show you how to get these types of equations, then you can see how this would basically boil down to just 1 minus cosine t, and this would boil down to t minus sine of t. Now, what a cycloid looks like, basically the idea is that if you have, let's say, for example, wheel, and you're focusing on a point on the wheel, and it's obviously moving along the ground, then it's basically what the path of this point takes. So if you rolled the wheel forward, the path of this point is going to take this general shape, and that's the shape of a cycloid, okay? Which again, you could go through the derivation of the formulas to get what we have here, but I just wanted to mention that for completeness. So what I'm going to do, as I already mentioned, is basically guide you through excuse me, the solution, but by letting M, H, E, E, and E equal, all equal 1. And then what you're going to do on the exam is do it in terms of the variables. And don't be intimidated, because I'm going to get you started with it in the outline of the solution for letting them all those constants be equal to 1 will help you along with the steps you need to follow to solve the differential equations. So I keep, you know, mentioning about you have to do it in general, okay? So explicitly in terms of those variables. But here's how it's going to look if we consider all of those to be equal to 1. Start with these two equations, the two given equations, and if we first, for simplicity, let, instead of using differential notation here for the second derivatives and the first derivatives, it's going to be simpler to use prime notations. So for the second derivative of x, we'll use x double prime, y double prime for the second derivative of y, x prime and y prime for the derivatives, first derivatives of x and y respectively. And so we just substitute those, and we have two equations that now at least look a little simpler to work with. So again, there's your x double prime, here's your y prime, this is your y double prime, and here's your x prime. Okay, and now I'm going to let everything equal 1, except, of course, for the variables x and y. And then we reduced these two equations, x double prime plus y prime is 1, and y double prime minus x prime is 0. So those are the two equations I'm going to start with. The initial conditions would be, using, again, the prime notation, x, its derivative, y, and its derivative are all 0. And we're going to solve this system to show that x is 1 minus cosine t, and y is minus sine t plus t, which is the same as t minus sine t, which is the path of a cycloid. And again, here I reiterated the fact that you're going to be asked to derive the equations explicitly in terms of the variables. And once I solve this system for letting all the coefficients be 1, I'm going to get you started on how to solve it explicitly in terms of those variables. So the solution is going to take quite a while, but let's at least get a little bit of a start here before I end this video. And the first thing I'm going to do, here's on the next page, it's basically blank. And if you printed out the lecture notes, the second page says solution and then it's blank. The third page is completely blank. And that's because it basically takes two pages to solve this problem, as we're going to see. So I'm going to start by first just saying that the first equation I'm going to label as Roman numeral 1, and that's going to be x equaling 1 minus cosine t, and then the second equation I'm going to label as Roman numeral 2, and that's going to be y equals I'm sorry, I meant to start with the originals, not the solutions. Okay, the original equations are x double prime plus y prime is 1. Okay, and I'm going to label that Roman numeral 1. Roman numeral 2 will be the y double prime minus x prime is 0. And off to the side, let me state the initial conditions so I don't forget. They were that x equals x prime equals y prime, everything taken to be 0. Okay, so note two things here to begin with, that this equation is a non-homogeneous, because it's equal to a function, in this case a constant, but it's not 0 is the point. But this one is homogeneous because it is equal to 0. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to solve this system by basically taking this first equation and solving for y prime, finding its derivative, and then substituting into this second equation. So if we have y double prime, in terms of x now, from this equation, we'll be able to substitute into this equation, and we'll have an equation in terms of x, in the derivatives of x. And then from there, we're going to do the reverse, solve this equation for x prime, find the second derivative, x double prime, and substitute back into number 1. And then we'll have an equation in terms of y, and we'll be able to end its derivatives, and so we'll be able to solve that. But a couple things that we definitely need to pay attention to as we go through this is the fact that when they're homogeneous or non-homogeneous, okay, those resulting equations. But we're going to solve the system momentarily. So I think I'm going to end there for now. I know there was just a brief introduction, but the solution's probably going to take about 20 minutes, so I want to end at that point, and we'll come back, and we'll start the solution to this famous experiment.